get to the salads.
Good morning.
Morning.
Oh, I'm going to try that again. The teacher in me really wants to try it again. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We are going to go ahead into honor time, and we are going to start. And I'm going to go ahead and begin, wanting, of course, to welcome everybody. I know that many of us have many things on our plate. So first and foremost, I do want to thank you for the time that you're going to put in today, as well as the effort. We are really hoping that today we're going to make some major steps in regards to moving forward. So I first of all want to begin by reviewing our roles, okay? Because the three of us, as you know, and I've said it over and over again, we do have some new committee members, and we will touch base with that later. But in the meantime, kind of want to go over Kristen Wingfield, Mindy Eves, and of course I am Suzanne Wright. For those of you who do not know me, our role as facilitators focuses on the process, okay? If you look on your table, there is a handout that looks like this. It has consensus at the top. And within that handout, you will notice towards the bottom, what does a facilitator do? I'm going to give you all about a half a minute to look over that.
Today, because we do have new members, and again, we will make sure that we know who they are during our icebreaker. So we ask that you be fully present. We do know that you have jobs and families, so we will provide a break. We ask that if you have to take a call, that you do step out and put your phone on mute so you can be fully present for this. Of course, we know that this is a very important process, and we need all of your minds present and fully engaged in this if we're going to have the best code of conduct possible. And you're doing a good job on welcoming each other, and please continue to do that and reach out to the new folks that are here today to ensure that they feel welcome at your tables. And they were added late, but they are still very important, and that should not take away from their importance here at this meeting. We ask that you always speak truths and respect each other's truths. Nobody is here to be fixed or advised. We all in our own rights have a lot to offer to this process, And so we ask that you listen with intentionality and be open and authentic with one another, and most importantly, be respectful of each other's truths and allow folks to have the ground whenever they speak. And I think we've done a very good job of that in the last two times. It's going to get hard at points. It's going to get tough whenever we hear things that are kind of the antithesis of what we see things. But we ask that you be open and flexible and consider the possibility and that person's positionality. Because based on that person's position and their job, it's going to impact how they see things, what their truths are. I talk about silence every time, and silence is good. Sometimes it's a moment to just reflect on what's been said and where we go next. And it brings me to a conversation that we need to have about silence from last time. Our last meeting together, we did a lot of work. We came down to a decision that you wanted to do levels when it came to disruptive behavior. And we were talking about what those levels, what that classification system looked like. And everybody just kind of glazed over, quiet, silent. And so I wanted to, did anybody want to contribute to that? What was that silence about? I want to make sure that we own that and talk about it. What do you think that, what contributed to that silence? Anyone that was here? So we can bring that our new folks, especially of today. What do you think, what contributed to that silence? What do you think that was about? Sheree, thank you! You saved me!
I feel like the silence kind of came from not knowing where to go next. The direction we just, I don't want to say we were stagnant, but it was like, when we had a consensus that we kind of liked this, but then it was like, okay, what do we do next? And I remember Terry Ray had a suggestion that kind of moved us into like, let's get some more information or thought about it for the next meeting. So that's where I felt it came from.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's right, and Terry did contribute to that to kind of help us move forward.
Which leads me, I just want to say, to piggyback off of what she said, that's why one of the things, we want to ensure that when it comes to your input, these meetings are truly organic in a way where we are based on what it is. So these aren't something that we have, and we kind of know exactly where we're going, because we are definitely making adjustments as we go based on what is going on. So when we talk about future meetings, it is truly organic in which, once again, for the suggestion of a committee member, okay, what can we do to best move forward in the most efficient manner? So thank you for bringing that up.
Anything else about silence that day? Silence is important. It lets us know. It allows us time to think. Anything else anybody wants to contribute to that about the silence on that particular day? Something that we should know? So the next piece is confidentiality. Being an ombudsman, I'm always concerned about confidentiality. Here today with my two facilitators, we're trained as facilitators in social change. We spent a lot of hours and have spent several more hours making sure that we're doing everything right in the spirit of being facilitators for social change to help the school district get the best possible code of conduct. So today I'm a facilitator, but I do want to remind you of confidentiality. We do have a communications department. The chief is Allison Martin. The deputy is Jennifer Brislin. And we ask that you please direct all questions from media and whatnot and other folks to our communications department. That's what they're here for. They are present today in this meeting, and we ask that you send all media questions to our communications department because they're the experts when it comes to communications. If there is a concern that you have about this committee, we always do a plus delta at the end. We ask that you please be open and honest with us. That's the way we know how to change things. Jackie, I think, said he wanted fruit today. He got fruit. And Terry said we need some examples. We have examples. And so we really want to make sure that, that we honor, what you have to say. So if there's something that you have to say about this committee, we ask that you do it here. With us all present, so we can, gain your insight, which I feel about it. We ask that you focus. Today is going to be a lot of tough stuff. You're going to do group work. No one's group work, I know that. We know that, you know, but what we do know as facilitators that you have a lot to offer, and the best way to ensure that everybody's voice is heard and we get the best possible code of conduct is for you to be focused together in a group, turning through those ideas so you can come up with a product for your group. And so with that, are there any questions about our guidelines? Okay. And as facilitators, at points we may say something just to make sure that we're protecting the space and ensuring that it's safe. I'm so happy that everybody's here. I will turn it over.
All right, thank you for participating. We're gonna go ahead and get into the nitty gritty. But before we do, I kind of want to create a bridge of some sort to kind of connect the dots, okay? I am not going to recap. I want you or somebody in the audience to be able to do some recap for me, kind of do some retelling of, especially for those who are new to the committee. Going back to day one, just give like a one brief synopsis of what occurred during day one. What was our main focus on day one of this committee meeting?
Setting expectations.
Okay.
Organization.
Setting expectations, the organization, and how we've structured everything. Correct? Anything else? Just think back. Yes, ma'am?
The longitudinal look at data.
Good deal.
Good data.
Okay. Why? Why do you think, anybody else, it doesn't have to be Terry, anybody, why do you think we looked at the data? Yes, ma'am. To see what we're working with, basically to do a deep dive within our current reality. Okay, anything else from day one?
We did that. We had a presentation, restorative practices.
Restorative practices, presentation. So in addition to the data presentation, we also had a restorative practices, presentation and possibly celebration for some of the things that have occurred as a result. So with that being said, why? Why do you think we delved into restorative practices? Definitely wasn't to fill time. Yes?
To educate the committee what restorative practices is all about.
Okay, I'm going to go into my five whys. Why do we need to educate the committee? Somebody else? Kim?
Build common knowledge.
Exactly. Build common knowledge. Because if you remember back one, we wanted to create that shared understanding because we all know that some of us might not have the same understanding with restorative practices. So the ultimate goal in that case was to bring everybody together, have the presentation, everybody hear the same message, everybody get a chance to ask questions, and then therefore have some really great dialogue that comes with that. Day two, which was just 2 weeks ago, although it seems like possibly an eternity for some, and that's when the silence occurred, so just kind of anchor you. The silence occurred, and then you were kind of, and I think Cherie kind of alluded earlier where in terms of where to go next. So just thinking back to day two, any thoughts?
Decision was made on day two. Seems to describe the decision and the point of conversation that you focused on.
I think we wanted to gain some background about what, you know, the cause and effect of districts that have made some gains in supporting children in a positive way.
Okay.
And so what practices move these districts forward?
Exactly.
So we were trying to get some background information or kind of stand on the shoulders of research, the literature.
Exactly.
And also stand on the shoulders of other districts that have moved forward to support children.
Okay. Great insight. Anybody else want to either add on or think of a new new thought that comes to mind with that? Next go around and just pull names. Okay. So one thing, and thank you for sharing that as well, because one of the things that we talked about specifically were deliberate disruptions. That is going to be our key idea. And when we talked about creating classification systems, that was as a result of a conversation that came about. Because I think one of the overarching pieces, and I, even though we've moved on to day three, I want to kind of continue to plant those seeds. Okay? Keeping in mind that one of the main things that occurred during that discussion was the definition of what? Anybody?
Literature.
disruption.
Exactly. The definition of deliberate disruption. So there was some, you know, conversation that occurred back and forth. So just to kind of keep that in mind as well as we move forward, I think it's important not to lose sight of what Jackie just said. And I want you to kind of every now and then think back to the difficulty that occurred when trying to define deliberate disruption and trying to actualize, you know, what does it mean exactly when, you know, and not only that, not only is it a disruption, but is it in fact a deliberate disruption or not? So there's a lot to that. So right now we're just going to take a moment to do just a, let's just do a share out type conversation and dialogue. You received yesterday a link, okay, with some articles, specifically with Baltimore and Buffalo on some classification systems, okay? So I do have a task that's going to occur after this, but let's just kind of take a minute to talk about some of the pros and cons and see if we can kind of determine, based on your reading, what are some of the pros of whether it's Baltimore or Buffalo. And we've got wonderful folks that will help scribe. So anything that you want to do, and here's what I'm going to ask, because we're going to kind of be moving back and forth the charts. Okay? If it's Baltimore, just say Baltimore pros, Baltimore cons, or if it's a Buffalo pros or a Buffalo cons. Okay? And as a teacher, I want to be able to provide resources instead of make it easier so you can highlight and do some jotting. We actually have copies of the two articles for you to look at on the right-hand side of these folders, and they are for you to mark up. So as you're thinking right now on pros and cons, refer to your articles. No, you can go ahead and start.
Baltimore Pro.
Okay, a Baltimore Pro.
Went into,
I'm sorry.
We're
okay. I'll start.
Okay. Yes, sir. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I felt that the Baltimore Pro was that it went into. Buffalo Pro went into more detail than the Baltimore one. So I saw that as a pro to help differentiate what disruptive behavior is and how we can hear it or level.
So the details, it was more detailed for Buffalo Pro. Okay, yes. Great job. And we're only going to spend about 10 to 15 more minutes on this, and then we're going to go into some additional work with this. But right now, we want a shared discussion regarding pros and cons. Thank you for your insight, Mr. Burke. Anybody else? Pros and cons, Buffalo or Baltimore? Kim?
Buffalo Pro, specific examples of intervention.
Okay. Specific. So I'm already seeing the details. We like the details. We like the specificity.
Specific examples of
interventions.
Interventions.
Anything else? Terry?
I piggyback on Kim. That's definitely a pro as far as listening to interventions, but I'd love to see every single thing being a live link. So in other words, I don't want to oversimplify interventions. So that's the con there. Because
okay.
There's a method in the madness. There's a way in which one implements those interventions. And so I want to make sure that those are easily accessible to our schools.
Okay. Thank you for bringing that up. And just want to reinforce, remember, this is a safe environment. Just because we state a con is not necessarily negating what somebody else in the room said. I want to make that very clear. Just because a con is said, that is not necessarily negating what somebody's input was provided within this committee. We want to be able to honor everybody's input. Sheree?
I want to say this is a Buffalo Pro, but have a con attached to it.
Okay.
The column that says may be referred to police, I think that, I don't like the title of the column, but I think it's important to determine what behaviors are justice system related and which behaviors are not.
Okay.
So it's a pro that there's a column that distinguishes things that belong in the justice system versus things that are school discipline issues.
Okay, good point. So that jurisdiction piece. Anybody else would like to contribute?
Kind of a pro and a con at the same time.
Okay, for Baltimore.
Buffalo.
Okay, give me a second. I got to catch up on
okay.
That definition.
Just as an intervention, kind of piggyback with some of the other folks that I like the idea of having specific interventions there, and then also having links so people can go to them quickly. Then also, as research comes out and says these are better interventions, is there a process in place that that links people to, you know, newer and better interventions at the same time? So it's dynamic versus just being a static applicant.
So is that a pro?
Well, that's, I think it's a, I think the pro is listing the interventions.
Okay.
Okay, and having links to those interventions quickly. And then the con is, if this is a static document and not a dynamic or a breathing document, then if there's new interventions that are coming on, or if the research doesn't support any of these anymore, these are still listed in the document. So, does that make sense?
Yeah. Needs to be dynamic.
Yeah.
List of interventions.
Adaptive. When it comes changes, good deal. Anybody else? Yes, Jackie?
Baltimore, Con. Is there a reason we picked Baltimore and Buffalo? Anybody know that?
Data. We asked data to give us some examples of the districts that they
Dr. Vanderhaar that was here last time
and
cited those as best practices.
Okay. Are these school systems the same as ours? The Baltimore spells, and we know. Baltimore says consequences to match the severity of the incident. We got rid of consequences last year and decided to go with corrective strategies because we didn't like the word consequences. So those are two cons for Baltimore. They expel and they say consequences. They expel for, I mean, up to, they can go 45 days, get out of school completely. No alternative school assignment, nothing, get out. So I think that's very good.
Okay. Expel. What was the other one? Expel and consequences.
The punitive language.
Okay.
In Baltimore code.
That's a great point. Punitive language. Okay, Terry Ray.
This is Baltimore also. Again, I'm just concerned. I just want to inquire about what's the outcome based on this code of conduct. And one of the things that I just, as I was just skimming, I noted that they have extended suspensions from 10 to 45 days. So we talked about that not being instructive last time. So I just want to make sure that this is yielding positive outcomes. So.
And Dr. Dossett can address some of the choices on Baltimore and Buffalo.
We were asked to provide examples of codes where they're specifically talking about disruptive behavior, failure to obey, and getting at the specificity and the intensity level. So it wasn't necessarily using the best model for the entire code. It was particularly for those here in that area.
That's great clarification.
So examples basically to springboard our discussion. So. Anybody else?
Just a logistical pro for both. They have differentiated for grades.
Okay.
One chart.
Good.
So it's all the same across the district, just differentiated by grade.
By grade level. Okay.
I just want to go back to something that I said at the restorative practices presentation about how we display these charts, and I feel like it's a pro that Buffalo, I feel like Buffalo's chart is easier to understand because Baltimore has all this stuff on the side, and I like the way that the information is presented in Buffalo. Okay.
Streamlined information and layout, okay. Two more minutes on this particular task. Yes, ma'am.
And to go with what Cherie just said, on each page, a pro for Buffalo, yeah, on each page it kind of gives you a reminder of what each level, level one, level two,
okay.
Level three, and sometimes we need that reminder, mm-hmm. You know, so it's on each page.
Reminder on each page, yes, Rhonda?
I want to add what Denise said, where I sit, it says under each level, when supports have been put, and that's level two, and then level three, when interventions and supports.
Okay. It's a safe environment, though, Ron.
Just take the profanity out.
You're trying to talk about equity?
When classroom procedures and systems are in place, when instruction, engagement, and everything is there, then the level should be part of the, not consequence, the response, strategy to redirecting the student, making sure the focus on the response is based on what the adults have control of. And that's why I like the word when.
So just to reiterate, correct me if I'm wrong, so it's basically when proactive?
Yes, it's
okay.
When reactionary and putting it.
All right.
So which code is that in?
Baltimore. That's a pro.
So a pro for Baltimore is
Buffalo.
Okay. So a pro for Buffalo is
Buffalo.
So when proactive, is that what you're kind of thinking?
It's proactive.
The levels are proactive.
Yes.
But reminding those who are implementing the response that it's necessary to have things in place before the child is being
Like the stages, of like the strategies based on.
But the language is clear.
Yeah.
Maybe that's another word I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
With, for example, if a kid is
clear language,
not opening their book because something happened in the classroom or whatever, and it was not addressed. So that's being defiant or refusing to follow the class norms or whatever. But they're not being like disruptive, but from the perception of the adult, they're being disruptive because they're not doing what everyone else is doing. But what is in place prior to that to prevent that or redirect that?
So if I'm hearing you right, so if we tried level one and we can record it, that didn't work, then we go to level two. If we can show data that didn't work, then we go to level three. Is that what it is, Ms. Cosby? If we tried one, then we need to try level one, then we need to try level two, and then if level two doesn't work, then we try level three. Go up the food chain. If the logical consequences were not effective in redirecting the learning of the students to positive replacement behaviors.
So this is definitely, like I said, time for you all to put out the pros and cons for this particular piece. What we're going to go do now is we're going to allow for additional discussion, but we are going to kind of make the group smaller and provide you with the task. We're going to leave these up here because, once again, these were pros and cons shared amongst the group. So for everybody to kind of hear. So if you give me some time and open your folder with me, and on the left side, Ms. Michaela, can you please read out loud what the cooperative small group work session task is?
Good morning. Based on the ratio related to the classification system, collaborative work with your team members to create a framework of a classification system that would effectively address the needs of students within Jefferson County Public School System. Utilize the chart paper to collect your ideas. We have allotted 1 hour for this task. Be prepared to share your ideas. The ultimate desired outcome is clear, revised code of conduct that reflects input from the code of conduct committee.
Thank you. Okay, this is going to be your task. Can I get a paraphraser? Thank you, Ms. Michaela, for reading. Paraphrase. What is your task? I told you all the teacher will come out of me. Dr. Beardsley, what's your task?
So we are going to collaboratively work with our team members. We're going to try to devise and come up with a framework that's going to address the needs of the students in our school system.
Okay.
We've got about an hour.
Thank you. And just to kind of reiterate, this is based upon, once again, initial input. We did the options before, so now we are going to kind of narrow in on the classification system, okay, within your group. So, but in addition to that, as you're working in your group, Mindy's going to talk about some expectations and just a couple of other things to touch upon as you're working with one another.
Okay, so now that you're going into groups, we're going to give you some guidelines to kind of help you, some principles to help you come up with the best design possible. Remember that we're all here together, and in order to do this, we have to be mindful, you know, that it takes relationships and collaboration to make this happen, all right? We're trying to really impact change in a way that reflects all of the data that we got early on, okay? Have a conversation with each other, all right? Think about building agreements. Remember that we're all here for the same reason. You know, we have all have a relationship to the code of conduct, and that we all care about students, and therefore we care about each other as well. Make sure that we're talking and engaging each other. If somebody is quiet and reserved or introverted, try to pull them in. Something is going on internally. If they don't feel like welcome to share, please try to bring in that person's voice in your group. Pay attention to power. Some of us have more power than others, maybe because we're extroverted, maybe because we have a certain position in the community or in the school district. Okay, let's use the power for good and for inclusivity, okay, not for exclusivity. We don't want anyone excluded from this conversation. Everybody is on a level playing field here. Plan well. We have given you charts, and you know what your task is. Make sure that you are moving along in the group to get the best design possible, because you are going to present out on it. And be flexible, okay? Because we all have some pretty strong opinions about this, because it's very important. We all have some link to the district, rather working here, or having students that go here, sometimes both, family members that work here. Maybe something has happened in relation to the code of conduct that has impacted you or your family or someone that you care about. So be flexible and understanding with one another, and be mindful of the fact that we do have a design that you, a task that you have to come up with in the end.
Okay, so there's an easel and a chart for each one. Now there's a little bit of some terminology that I want to clarify. So at last meet, the meeting 2 weeks ago, we talked about how to handle deliberate disruption. And we presented three options, we discussed them, advocated for them, and the committee came to a consensus, something that everybody can live with and support implementation of leveling disruptive behavior. For those of you all that are coming on board, the two other options were: one, remove it from the code of conduct altogether, or the other option was to just eliminate the ability to suspend for deliberate disruption. But the committee, through discussion and advocacy, came to consensus around leveling deliberate disruption. So additionally, in your folder, thanks to Chuck Bird, and it was also included in the presentation last week, is some information on bills. And so this talks a little bit about some levels that are already being used, but the descriptions are pretty, still not very clear, but this could be a starting point for some of the conversation.
The reason I suggested this to the committee is because we're already using it, and those who do use bills, behavior intervention laws, should be familiar with it, and this was just a general suggestion. If the committee needed more direction on tiering, I wanted to show an example of what we're using as a tiered process for disruptive light behaviors.
Great, so we appreciate Chuck providing that. So what we've done here is we've kind of outlined a structure. Best practices, Dr. Vanderhart just shared last time, that kind of three levels of deliberate disruption is kind of a best practice. So we're kind of gonna work with that as kind of our framework to do it. So in the two examples that we looked at, the word level referred to the strategies. In our world, level is going to refer to what the disruption was. So I think that's an important difference. Our strategies in our current code of conduct that are across the top will remain the same. Those will not be changed to levels, but what we're talking about is what level the disruptive behavior is.
The intensity.
There you go. So the intensity of it. So your kind of assignment is to have discussion among your table, but the end result needs to be completion of this chart, which includes a name of the level and then a description. So for example, the Bills goes with like a mild, moderate, and severe. Is that what we want to call our levels? And then a description of the mild. In the Bills, it talks about being on the student versus being in the classrooms versus disrupting the whole school. So is that how you all want to define the levels within your group? Or is there another way that you want to work towards defining kind of the levels of deliberate disruption? You know, there's been some discussion around the violence level of it. So if I'm just out walking the hallway, that could be deliberate disruption. But also if I shove a desk over and push the teacher's aide on the way out the door, that's deliberate disruption. So which one, so you know, how do you want to define the different levels? And then a pretty specific description of what you all are including in that motion. Any questions before we kind of turn you loose in the group? Mindy and Suzanne and I will kind of walk around. We'll help kind of guide your group if you all get stuck on certain things or kind of give you some thoughts of moving forward. So we'll be there as a resource. If you have any questions or want us to come facilitate directly at your group, we're happy to do that. All right, so the time is yours to discuss among your groups. If we want to, if you all are, I put us close for a reason, but if you all want to scoot away, I think you all can do that. Pull the chart paper in. I think there may even be another room if somebody wants to go to another smaller room to have a discussion. I'll leave those options there. That's it. Begin discussing. Yeah.
Everything's going to be
They contain theirs, but they contain the community. These are up for interpretation. It's not really.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because anybody knows when they see. see if we're trying to.
I was just.
What this I thought that last meeting.
Well, I think not fit this obviously. But I think for people like kids, they know still things is in what I want. Better than actually they. That's what I was balanced. They didn't like what I said, but they could not.
The crisis itself. So really, one is the thing that the admin is supposed to be in place. The rest of it.
I mean, I.
There was a disagreement.
I agree with the magic of what you're saying. I mean, well.
Well, part of the reason.
The location.
Notification of the gate.
Exactly. There's a difference. Location. The gate and the disciplinary process. Or the intervention. The location is just. Look, Johnny. That's all.
Three.
Yeah. I think that they catch up. Baltimore 15. Baltimore and. Different behaviors that all under the. I love to see how much more explicit under there. Much more explicit. Like you said, it's very. So much.
Exactly. It's when you have support.
Very different from reality. Kids will take all their effort and energy and sometimes manipulate to disrupt the first season.
Look at that.
So what you said, it's.
Whoever's responsible.
Well, I was going to say, you know, we're talking about. But there were. It's kind of hard for me to do it.
I nothing to its impact on students, colleges, or the educational environment.
And they put on their strategies now, but it's hard to.
For example, might be like a verbal plan.
Because what is mild, severe, minor?
So you all start thinking about which boxes would be graded in.
Or the box.
So I'll give these boxes on, whatever you all would call it.
So is it the RF? Talking about right here.
Yeah.
This is something I want to clarify. Doing different levels. Yes. So you could put like different strategies.
Elementary, pre-K, or fifth?
That's right. Yeah, I know it doesn't say that. That's right.
The strategy is the same for high level.
This
And it still could be an isolated, it could be one time that and if everybody changes, it's really significant. The ratio, the short is punctured, that's it.
Suzanne, did you have a question?
Is that triggered, that moderate or adult, or moderate or specific?
I'm on that address. Out of, I said I'm out of,
And I also think a lot of your research.
Well, from the level where for the attention.
And I have to do it. Each one of those.
Go and then the strategy level.
Duration.
So the levels we're talking about.
This would be what the student's doing, and then our peers are responding.
They don't necessarily have to match. You're more than that educational requirement. Which is what this one would be.
Well, to me, we're gonna have to change this chart.
It's a bit of a while with the
Yeah, exactly.
So I think this is kind of an informal, as a group, deciding, you know, what the process is. We all reach a little juncture where it's a challenge.
You mean, they're like there.
Because then I think it is.
But can we go back to this? Right.
Let me ask you this. Do you think they can use it in your life? This isn't, like, you know, is this making it exhaustive? Because I know one of my problems with Baltimore, I think, was that it's anything else, somebody needs it disruptive, like, why is that? If you're trying, say whatever you want. So we don't want that, but, I mean, for me,
but if we can write a code that gives a better guidelines of it, and then, of course, the second part is the training, how are we implementing it after school, coming out and watching it, is it coded, is it there? So, I mean, that's the second part, which we are not charged, we're not ready, and we're not charged, this committee is not charged with dealing with that, that's not about the general marshal's office. But if you can, right now, it just says it's a disruption. What can we do to better define it? Not 100%, it's also defined, but better. We're not going to be able to push every single person, but it's
that kid's doing it multiple days, and that's the thing, take more time.
So Bob versus Mike trying to log in. Just on the frequency count, if I keep bugging Stan,
I think there is, we can do better than deliberate. So the question is, I mean, we can go with just a
We can just see if this fits.
Hold on, Tim. I would say that you're on the spot.
Because it didn't say it hadn't happened. On Mari, you can say.
Duration for
but that's what I'm saying, that's what I'm saying, to give you a way out,
So the duration is short. The intensity.
So when we say students, you're the student.
So it would shit over that here.
All right, I just want to do a quick time check. We have 10 more minutes on this task, followed by Ray.
Miles, the teacher that is confined to student or students near them, and then example, scowling, off task, verbally distracted, crossing arms, pouting, muttering under his or her breath, trying to explore, driving, or driving.
Short, what's up?
I'm just gonna put.
And then the next one we do.
Do you have scissors?
No.
Sir.
Okay, here.
I keep running on the.
Where's the table?
different level of
Right.
It's not just
So if I did this to you, did that hurt you? I threw that at you, so should I get suspended? But if I take that didn't give you
Frequency of what?
Because I think that's what we're getting,
you know, be able to
So frequency.
Just a question.
Well, I think both of them
My problem was, as a teacher,
a brief moment in terms of, you know, was this a difficult task? more importantly, why? Why was it a difficult task? And I want you to think about that as your roles, that you, in terms of what you bring to the table, and the next steps regarding this is something to, you know, that will be implemented district-wide. So I want you all to think about, this is input for that, but more importantly, if it in fact was a difficult task, why? So with that being said, we're gonna put 10 minutes on the clock for your break. You can do as you please, and we'll see you back in about 10 minutes. Thank you.
We have a consensus.